The following video was sponsored by the Greek American Heritage Society of Philadelphia, preserving and promoting our community's history.
Phillipsburg, Pennsylvania, the local carpenter, the pool hall, and of course here, Carpenter's Hall in Philadelphia. What makes them special, what unites them, is the journey and life of the gentleman we're about to talk to, Nick Gianopulos. Nick, welcome to Cosmos Philly and to the Greek American Heritage Society of Philadelphia. Tell us a little bit about the significance of Carpenter's Hall historically that we talked about as you came in.
Well, look, let me start. First of all, I want to thank you for interviewing me. You know, I am highly complimented to that. Your willingness to do it. But you mentioned just a second ago, you know, my town of Phillipsburg in Center County, just west of Penn State. I was born and grew up in Phillipsburg and left it after graduation in high school, went to war, World War II in 1944. And my older brother also did. We both were drafted and served abroad in Germany, Battle of the Bulge, and all the keynote things that took place, excepting D-Day. Thank God for that. I had no regrets for missing that one. Growing up in this little town of 3,500 people, it was an Anglo-Saxon town, a mercantile town for the surrounding coal mining and refractory facilities. And my father had a billiard hall where I learned to play pool as a youngster, how to rack balls, and knew the difference between the various games. At the same time, enjoyed just growing up in this town. One of my father's best friends, a hunting companion of his until he got arthritis and couldn't fire a gun anymore, was the town carpenter, Andy Fravel. And he was a veteran of World War I. And when Andy was doing a job in town between the elementary school or the junior high school in which I went to, and my father's tap room or bar, or billiard hall first and later a tap room, I would walk from the school to my dad's place every day, and on the way, if Andy Fravel had been working on a building, I would divert and go see what Andy was doing. And he used to hand me a saw and a tube of four, and he would say, "Hey, cut this, I've been waiting for you all day," you know. Well, of course, you know, that was a great ego booster, but it also introduced me into construction, simple construction, wood frame construction. That coupled with the fact that I was interested in airplanes, making model airplanes and so on.
You mentioned that your father used to give you 10 cents on Saturdays.
So that I could go buy a used model airplane magazine from which I would take the photographs, or if they had drawings, I would magnify them, you know, drafting-wise. I had a lot of drafting skills when I was in grade school, you know, just the sense of bringing things together, combining them, building them, I think was intrinsic with my nature, my natural nature. One thing led to another. I came back from the war, studied architectural engineering, came to Philadelphia in 1950, never left, never regretted it, and made a lot of wonderful friends, was accepted by the Carpenters Company to be a member in 1976, and I taught adjunct at Penn for 25 years, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know, I look back with the pride of having been able to preserve most of the significant historic buildings in Philadelphia.
Well, let's talk about that briefly, starting with Carpenter's Hall here. You said something very poignant early on when you walked in about Carpenter's Hall that people should know.
Well, the Carpenter's Hall, in a sense, and I think you use the term, has always played second fiddle to Independence Hall, the State House. But the Carpenter's Company, who had just completed this building, made it available to the representatives of the First Continental Congress who came here, because they couldn't go to the State House because the State House was a Tory haven at the time. And these people were all striving for, you know, independence. They really they wanted a fair shake first, but the Brits would not give them a fair shake. And so the next thing was, well, let's jump ship. And they met here and formulated what, you know, how they were going to approach doing that. Now, in this particular space that we're seated at here, there used to be a partition from that column to this pilaster and the same over there with a central hall, and this was known as the East Room. This was known as the East Room, which we're sitting in, and this is where they met and convened to have their discussions. Now, this room, as we see it today, without the partitions, is reminiscent of when it was restored in the 1850s.
Well, let's talk about the, if we can, let's talk about the preservation work that you were involved with in this building and when that took place.
Well, all right, I'll lead into this. I had been doing a report on Christ Church, the Second Market, with Charles Peterson, the eminent architectural historian, probably the most preeminent one of his time, who was a member of the Carpenter's Company. And Peterson said to me more than once, he said, "Wouldn't you like to join the company?" And I, like a dummy, I said, "Well, what company?" And he said, "Carpenter's Company." I said, "Well, how do I get into it?" And he says, "Well, if you want to go, I'll recommend." You know, so he nominated me for a membership, and I came in 1976, the fall of 76. Just missed meeting the Queen when she came over here with Prince Philip. And it was interesting. Christ Church asked us to reinforce the galleries, the balconies in Christ Church, so that they could have a full occupancy. And I did an investigation, found them to be substandard. We reinforced them in anticipation that the Queen and Prince Philip would visit the building while they were here. They didn't go, they came here instead. One of the things that they were concerned about here was this great deflected roof or floor above us. And it was deflected about 2.5 inches across. And my investigation led to becoming familiar with two huge timber trusses buried into the partitions in the second floor. And there's a diagram on it out there in the entry case. And the crux of the problem was, this is very simple, the building originally had a wood shingle roof. Now, a wood shingle roof only weighs 3.5 pounds a square foot. It's not very heavy. In the 1850s, they put a slate roof on it. So it went from 3.5 pounds a square foot to 12 pounds a square foot when they put the slate on it. Then in the 1950s, They took the slate off because the slate was almost 100 years old and was breaking up. And they put on simulated wood shingles, which are up there now. If you look at it, it looks like it has a shingle roof, but it's not a shingle roof. And they're terracotta tile. They're terracotta tile. So it went from that 12 pounds from the slate up to 15 pounds a square foot. So there was five times as much weight on the roof as when the building had been constructed. Now, let's add insult to injury. When you go into the library on the east side, on the west side, upstairs, there are library cases from the floor to the ceiling. They weigh 600 pounds per lineal foot. So all the additional load that was put on this, what was considered a well-built timber frame building, you know, in the 1720s, they had now the equivalent of a 10-ton truck up there on the roof. So if you can visualize, if you put a 10-ton truck on that, what's going to happen? It deflected, it deformed, it cracked, there were members that fractured. And so that, they brought me in as a member, and I learned later the reason doing it, they did it so that I could be the engineer for doing the remediations.
So that was part of your career with Keast Hood?
Yes, I was already a Keast Hood.
Well, let's talk about them a little bit here and the preservation work and some of the contemporary work that you were involved with.
All right, okay. I came to the city in 1950, Thanksgiving, and went to work for an older engineer. His name was William H. Gravell, Major Gravell, major from World War I, Corps of Engineers. And he liked the three young fellows he had. He had Ray Hood, Dandy Bone, and myself. And he wanted to break out from Gravell and Duncan into Gravell Associates. They dissolved that partnership. They formed Gravell Associates with the younger fellows in it. Gravell was considered to be the dean of engineering here in town because he was really a very competent guy, and I was very fortunate to have gotten a job with him. For instance, he engineered the Packard building, he engineered the bleacher systems for Franklin Field, he did the approaches to the Benjamin Franklin Bridge, those big trusses before you get to the suspension part. The man was competent and quite versatile. And well, anyways, when we had formed Gravell Associates, a very important architect, George Howe, and Robert Montgomery Brown came to him and said, "Major, we want you to do the bulletin building for us at 30th Street, which Drexel now owns over there." And so, you know, and at the same time, I met Louis Kahn, you know, who was a, George Howe was his mentor. And so there's, you know, there's this kind of mix going on in the city here, you know, where architects and engineers get to know each other through various, you know, projects. Well, Gravell, instead of putting me on the bulletin building as they did with the other guys, he put me on the mall project over here where they were starting to tear down two blocks of buildings from Chestnut Street up to Vine and Race. And I was surveying the basements, the sub-basements, and because once that building was, once all of those buildings were taken down and cleared and the basements filled in, they were going to start building walls along the perimeter to bound it. and those walls are there now. And that brought me into this part of town for the first time. I'd walked through here. In fact, I lived at 22nd and Delancey, and I used to walk every Sunday down to St. George's to go to services. So in a way, I had a familiarity down here, but then work brought me here, and I started to enjoy this stuff, you know. I came and visited these buildings. The irony of it was the old Jewish woman that I was rooming with, who had been raised, in Philadelphia, had never been in an Independence Hall ever herself, and she had never been to Carpenter's Hall either. So, it's just, the nature of how people are attracted one way or the other.
Well, let's talk about some of the other preservation work around Philadelphia and some of the contemporary work, how your life intertwined between both.
I was fortunate in being able to conduct my practice as a partner of Keast Hood in two tracks. One was a preservation track, the other one was the engineering of contemporary buildings. And my earliest work was always in contemporary buildings, and which continued up until the middle 80s. But at the same time, I was involved in doing this work on the buildings here in the park, in Independence Park, and my associations with the National Park Service took me beyond Philadelphia, up and down the coast. I did work down at Fort Pensacola, I did work Fort Sumter and Charleston.
Are there any particular memories of these projects or challenges that you met by working on these preservation projects that we can mention?
They all had challenges. The most challenging project I ever had was the emergency at the Academy of Music. In 1989, we were doing the structural engineering for the installation of two new passenger elevators in the Academy. It did not have passenger elevators. It just had stairs up until then. And the Annenberg Foundation was funding this. And one of my assistants, a young woman, I had her as the project engineer on that particular project, had gone over there, and I'd asked her to go up into the attic above the north wing, the chestnut or the Locust Street side, to examine the overrun of the elevator tower and see that it did not have meet obstructions with the trusses over there. And as she went up there, she found a major truss over the auditorium, which had fractures in it. And she told me about it. I had been out of town that day, but we went back up there on Friday, had a job meeting. She took me upstairs, she showed it to me, and she had called it right. It was a fracture. What had happened was that bottom cord of this 90-foot truss over the auditorium had fractured. And the way you could tell it was a new fracture, not an old one, is as the wood separated and failed, the wood was white, clean, there was no dust in it, whereas everything else was covered with dust. So you could see that, had it been an old fracture, it would have oxidized, changed its color, and so on like that, and there would have been dust and dirt in the joint. So her call was right. So while she and I are looking at this, the orchestra is beginning it's 2 o'clock concert downstairs, Friday afternoon matinee. And so Suzanne challenged me. She says, well, what are you gonna do about it? I said, we'll go down and tell them they have a problem here. So we went down to the green room, that's down on Chestnut Street, where you make the entry into the stage. And there was the manager was there, and the construction manager for the elevator project was there. It just so happened that the executive director of the Orchestra Association was there. So I explained to them what happened. And the question that was put to me was, if L and I at City Hall knew about this fracture that you're reporting to us now, what would they do? I said, they'd close the building down. So the guy says, we'll close it down now. And so intermission came just there. We're out in the green room. We can hear it on the PA. Intermission came. The executive director, Stephen Sell, went out. He says, ladies and gentlemen, I am here to inform you that our engineers tell us that there is a failure in one of our systems. Well, everybody thought it might be the plumbing, it might be the electrical work, it might be the air conditioning or whatever, you know. But they didn't say the structure was failing. And so they excused everybody.
There was no panic.
No. We had gotten the head ushers in and told them beforehand what this was about. And so everybody applauded and went out, and, you know, and they gave him a rebate on, you know, the ticket and whatnot. Well, the funny thing is, that particular night, Pavarotti was supposed to sing Long Bohème there with the Philadelphia Opera Company in the Academy. They called Pavarotti over at the Four Seasons and said, Maestro, canceled tonight. And so, you know, Pavarotti is a pretty cool guy, and he says, you know, I'm sitting here looking out the window, I'm looking at the cathedral, the Catholic cathedral over on the circle there. I happen to know, you know, the Monsignor there. Well, he called the Monsignor wasn't there, so they gave him another bishop, and finally they got down to a guy who was responsible for the cathedral there, and Pavarotti said, can we sing there tomorrow night? Can we present the opera to there tomorrow night on a Saturday night? He was told, only if you do it in concert, no costumes, no drama, you do it as a choir. So lo and behold, La Boheme was staged the next night over there, once and only. And it made the papers and so on. Well, in the meantime, Suzanne and I were working every day from at least 7 a.m. till 8 or 9 p.m, 14 successive days. We got the contractors in there, and the work went around the clock, around the clock. Carpenters were sleeping in the corridors, heavily carpeted corridors that go around. They're called the ambulatories. And steel was being brought in, wood was being, you know, manipulated and so on. But they opened it, reopened 17 days after the discovery.
That's amazing.
It's amazing. It's amazing.
Last week when we talked, we brought up World War II and how it played a pivotal role in shaping the future of your career. We talked about Germany post some of the destruction and how you saw these structures visible, the interior, the skeletal interior of these structures. Tell us about that and how it really influenced your career also.
Well, look, I'll take the liberty of starting with the fact that Pearl Harbor, December the 7th, 1941, is what brought us into the war. I was a senior in high school at the time, and many of my classmates just left school, volunteered out of patriotic motivations, and went into the service. Some never came back. Following graduation, Penn State, which is 23 miles away, initiated some training programs to prepare people for the war industries. So that summer after graduating high school, I took this extension course and ended up working in Buffalo with Bell Aircraft. Then I got drafted, and I reported to go to my induction center on January the 5th, 44. From there, they sent us to Fort Knox, where I trained, you know, I took an armored training, basic training, learning to drive tanks, shoot all kinds of weapons, and so on. And I was 19 years old at the time. And shipped overseas in September of 44. And the irony of it is my brother was also. And the irony of it was we met at the port of embarkation on the Hudson River just south of West Point, accidentally in a dining hall. There must have been 5,000 people in this gigantic dining hall. Ran into him, and I visited him that night, and the next day they got us out. We marched down to the train and headed for the ship down in New York Harbor, and went overseas on the Ile-de-France, 8,000 or 9,000 guys on the ship. I met a couple of other fellows who had been from my hometown on the ship just by chance. And my brother left a day or two later, and he went over on the Queen Mary, and he got there before we did. They got there in 5 days because they'd picked up Winston Churchill and took him over. It took us 10 or 11 days to get over. Eventually, I end up up in the Siegfried Line as a replacement. Ninth Army, it was part of the Ninth Army I went into, and we were next to the British. The British were north of us. Patton was to the south of us. And I was taken in to become a member of a reconnaissance company. And armored reconnaissance.
Tell us about your involvement and tell us about the book. You became a member of this organization, Eleftheria VFW Post 6633. Tell us.
Right, okay. Let me tell you the background on this. I had never, although I valued my wartime experiences, and my partners were all veterans. We're all veterans, so, you know, we had a little camaraderie and exchange of stories. Little white lies, you know, was, and but in a sense, I felt obligated to somebody for my GI Bill experience. And as I continued to read on the side on subjects that interested me, I found out that it was the VFW and American Legion veterans from World War I who lobbied Congress during World War II for the GI Bill, for the benefits. And, you know, it was coming time to retire. I was 85 when I retired from the office. And, you know, when they talk about people wanting to retire at 58, I can't understand that. But anyways, I felt obliged, and I never belonged to any veterans organizations. And a godbrother of my wife, Tom Gumas, who has a narrative in here, was having breakfast with his wife with us one day, one Saturday, and he said, "I've just joined the VFW." And I knew he was referring to Lefadia. He said, "Why don't you join up with me?" So I said, "Yeah, all right, I think I'll do it as payback because I need to support somebody who gave me my education." And so that's how I joined the VFW. And so we got over there and to the meetings. And at every meeting they were saying, "How's the history book coming? There were hardly ever responses or whatever, you know, or no report today. And after the, like the fourth or so meeting, I said, can I help? And so they made me the chairman of the book, the book committee. And so I worked on this thing for easily 3 years, 3.5 years, researching the histories of these men. Most of the men that I wrote about here had already been dead. You know, they had been members of Lithidea. And by obtaining discharges, copy of their discharges, military discharges, I was able to develop their service chronology, and then I could flesh it out with my knowledge of the various campaigns in the Pacific or Europe, or as the case may be.
Well, give us a little background about the men in general. Where were they? They were all Greek Americans from the Philadelphia area, I guess?
Yes, they were. Yes, we had a couple of non-Greeks in there who, they were Italian guys, but who wanted to belong, and of course, you know, you could not exclude them. The rules of, you know, becoming a member are not ethnically oriented, but these guys, you know, would only invite Greek Americans to join. And of course, that's the problem today. It's dying out. And I would venture to say in 10 or 15 years, there may not be in the Lithidea because they've not recruited replacement people.
So let's talk about your Greek heritage briefly. Your family comes from where?
Okay, just by coincidence, my father and mother came from the same village, but they were 17 years apart. You know, my mother was quite young. And the village was Tripotema, which was about 6 to 8 kilometers south of Megalopoli, you know, in Arcadia. And my father came here in 1902, preceded by an older brother who was working on the B&O railroad tracks in the northwestern part of the state. He sent my father tickets and passage and so on. He eventually came over and he got a job there. And his older brother was eventually killed. My mother came over with her three sisters and her father, and they went to Ipswich, Massachusetts, just before World War I, 1914 or 13. And the women worked in the textile mills up in Ipswich. The Greek men in this country, you know, naturally at home they were accustomed to receiving a dowry when they married into a family. Well, these men were making money over here and they were independent. They just wanted a Greek wife. They didn't care about the dowry. And so they were writing these letters back and forth to the village, tracking where the young women might have migrated to the U.S. And my father had a cousin who had come over and joined him here. He was a candy maker, and he, through the mails, found this wife up in Ipswich. My father went as best man, and there he met his future wife, my mother. And so they went into the candy business and were very successful. They eventually, in the 1920s, moved down to Phillipsburg, PA, from Kane, PA. And that's where I was born.
I remember you told me last week there's a particular point of interest here between your mother and your father.
Oh, yes.
Your father was at a baptism in Greece?
Let me
go ahead. I have to hear this one.
This is an amusing story. My father had his tickets and baggage packed to come to the U.S., and he was at the little train station, the little stone building outside of Tripotema. And the station master said, there's been a landslide and the track is blocked. It'll be a few hours before the track is cleared. Why don't you get back to the village? They're having a christening today. Well, my father went to this christening, and lo and behold, this little girl, who was about a year old, was being christened. Well, it turned out to be his future wife. His future wife, you know, and my mother. And my father used to joke with her later. He says, you know, if there hadn't been a landslide, we probably would never have gotten married. You know? But anyways, my parents never got back to Greece again. You know, because they went through the Depression, which wasn't easy. And then the World War II came along, and you know, my father would love to have gone back after the war. He was very active in Greek war relief in the town, you know, going around and getting everybody to get trunks of clothing and whatnot and sent them to Greece. And I think most of my World War II, my brother World War II army uniforms were sent to Greece as well following the war.
Talk about, let's talk about preservation of culture at home. Was the Greek language used at home?
Yes, my parents spoke Greek all the time in the house, and as kids we did, as children we did. And as a matter of fact, the story was that when my brother went, who was 4 years older than I, went to first grade, he couldn't speak a word of English. And he learned English when he was in first grade. You know, he eventually became a country doctor later and delivered 7,000 babies. He was not an OB specialist, it just they had a lot of babies up there, that's all.
Was it awkward for you growing up in Phillipsburg? There probably wasn't a large Greek community. Was it different?
There was no Greek community. There were three Greek families, and we were all related. And probably our most of our kinship were with the Jewish families. The Jews were Orthodox up there, and my best friend was a Jewish fellow up on our next corner that I would walk to school every day, and we would walk home for lunch and walk back again. And right across the street from his house was a little synagogue that they had built. They had a Polish rabbi and his wife come in just before the war began. And down on the next corner from where we lived was the Jaffe residence. He was a beer distributor, and he and my father were the closest of friends, and Mrs. Jaffe and my mother were the closest of friends. You know, we had a very close relationship with the Jewish families. And of course, they had the best dry goods stores and clothing stores in the town. But it was an Anglo-Saxon town, is what it was. And the principal churches were the Episcopal, the Presbyterian, and the Methodist. Then there were others as well, but those. And there was a fair Catholic contingent, but surrounding the town of 3,500 people were these villages, as much as 10 or 15 miles away, where all the coal miners and refractory workers lived and so on. And it was the very edge of the soft coal field, you know, which stretched from West Virginia up to Western Pennsylvania into Central Pennsylvania. And there was a valley which ran down through the center of the state, and Penn State was on the east side of it, and Phillipsburg was on the west side. The coal stopped there, the limestone began there. And so there were various industries associated with the minerals and so on.
Customs, traditions, and faith.
Okay.
What did you do for church and maybe holiday social gatherings?
We were, the families, the three families always observed the name days. Uh-huh. Always the name, the patron saint's name days. We were parishioners with Trinity Church in Altoona, 35 miles away. And we would get over there twice a year to take communion. But the rest of the time we attended church of the Episcopal Church. And it was interesting in 1936 when Athenagoras made a pilgrimage, you know, to visit all the churches. He came to Altoona, and my father took us over, you know, to meet him. Athenagoras at the time was the archbishop here in this country before he became the patriarch, you know. My father told him, we attend so-and-so because it's not convenient to come over here. We didn't have a car at the time, and my father would always pay somebody to drive us over and back. Athenagoras said, fine, attend the Episcopal Church. He said, but don't take the sacraments. Save yourself for here twice a year. And that's what we did. We grew up that way before the war and after the war. But eventually my brother became an Episcopalian, my sister became an Episcopalian. I came to Philadelphia and remained an Orthodox. But the community in Altoona was a very friendly community. Most of the people were either in mercantile work, theater business, or they worked in the railroad shops for the Pennsylvania Railroad. They had the big central shops there. Of course, Amtrak has shops there now, you know, instead. We had relatives who had a small hot dog facility, you know, near the shops. Eventually, my Uncle Jim, who ran it, died, and his son, Ange, who took over, you know, his mother just marveled at how much money he was making. He was making so much more money down there than his father used to make. And Ange had been going to school at, I forget, Slippery Rock State Teachers or one of those colleges. What he was doing is he was selling numbers and making money on the numbers down there. But, you know, his mother was kind of a naive woman, and, you know, she just thought it was absolutely wonderful he could make such a go of the place.
Let's talk a little bit about your love of photography as well. It's tied into Hellenism. There's a trip or two that you took back, and there's a series of black and whites. Let's talk about those.
I, as a youngster, loved photography, and I still do. And today, I still use a film camera. The camera is a Rolleiflex. It's my second Rolleiflex. I've had two Rollecords besides. But this camera I bought used in '89, the pictures that you see that I brought here for you today were practically all taken with that camera. The secret of I brought in a selected group of photographs for you to see, and of course, as far as I'm concerned, the photography is one aspect of it, but the processing and printing is the heart of it. Is really the heart of it. And I was fortunate in meeting a fellow by the name of Bob Asman here in Philadelphia, who did a lot of the printing for me and processing. And Bob is now down in North Carolina. He wanted to change a venue. So he went down there where he enjoys the mountain scenes. And that's why he went there. Well, he's busier down there than he was ever up here. But I think you'll see that all the stuff I have here is on archival paper and processed. And just out of curiosity, it was an old Omega D3 enlarger, you know, with the best, Nikkor lens he could get for the thing. But anyways, photography, to me, is almost a way of living. I will visualize a scene that I have seen, and if it's an ideal scene from my point of view, in terms of composition and, you know, lighting and whatnot, I won't wait a year for the calendar to come around until I know the sun is low, the leaves are coming down. Beth and I are going to go tomorrow for a place I've been reconnoitering for almost a year, and we're ready to get that picture tomorrow if it doesn't rain.
Well, give us just an idea in general about this body of work, where it's from and what it's about.
Well, there's a mix in here. I have brought what I thought would be my most interesting shots that I took in Greece. The Greek shots are mostly, you might say, architecturally related. I have a few other shots which are family shots. Showing the diversity of what could be done. And I learned to work with the shortcomings of the camera and capitalized on them, as you will see. For instance, you know, in here we don't have much interest in the ceiling here, but I have a couple of shots there of a skylight, a skylight in the State Capitol building of Connecticut. And I do that by putting the camera on the floor and exposing it with a self-timer. Of course, get good meter readings, et cetera, and so on, you know. But I think you have to look at them, you know, go through them individually.
Well, it looks like your life has been full and busy, and you continue to work. And there's one more project that you're working at right now. It's your memoir. Could you talk about the memoir and your family, who they are today?
Well, after having done this thing, in which there were many things that I couldn't put in here that I would like to have put in here, I started to cobble together stories about my parents' immigration, or growing up in a town, war experiences, what we did professionally. My brother was a country doctor, my sister was a choral director on Long Island, and I was a Mr. Fix-It here in Philadelphia. We moved out to Gladwin, the little village near Ardmore, Bryn Mawr, and bought a little bungalow there that we were going to live there for a couple of years, but we've been there 53 years instead. Had a family of three children, and...
Well, tell us their names.
The oldest was Christiana, and she's an attorney up in West Hartford. And the second child was Elia, named after my father. Elia is a research and development engineer at Boeing Helicopter, been there for 35 years. And the baby of the family is Beth. She doesn't like to be called the baby, but anyways, that's Beth. And Beth is taking a period of her life off to look after her father and mother, you know. And since my wife is in her upper 80s and I'm my lower 90s.
You didn't mention your wife's name. What's her
name? My wife's name is Andonia.
Andonia.
And I have a picture of her in there, of that box, when we were courting. And she was a pretty attractive young woman. She graduated from Penn. And earned part of her tuition by teaching piano at that time, and was a pretty diverse, well brought up Greek girl.
Grandchildren?
She's made her adjustments.
Are there grandchildren?
Yes, we have two grandchildren. Delia has two children, two daughters. who were 9 and 11, let's say, very talented young girls, great athletes, good swimmers. And I wouldn't be surprised they might get swimming scholarships when they're in college, when they go to college. They're that good. At their age, you should see them, they're like machines. Of course, they're taking lessons from professionals. So it's not just casual swimming.
I'm assuming all this is part of what you're putting together in the memoir, too, to some extent.
The second book I'm writing, which is a family history, is quite diverse. And right now, my focusing is I'm not writing really for the family, I'm writing for the profession. I've taken like 6 major projects that I felt were significant in my professional career, and I have developed them in detail, really great detail, so that I know that this will be taken and put in the architectural archives at Penn. It'll probably be down here at the National Park Service. There will be numerous, Pennsylvania Historical Society will want it. So it'll be there, and I'm hoping the stories of, for instance, of how we remediated and repaired Carpenter's Hall will be of interest to somebody. And I think it will be in the future. And the same thing, the Fairmont Waterworks is one of my favorite projects. Academy of Music, because of the pressure that we had to work under to correct what had happened there. And then the Merchants Exchange, which is right down the street here, which is where the National Park Service, Philadelphia, has its offices. Independence Hall and this and that and so on. You know, they just go on and on and on. You know, Christchurch is one. But I feel very pleased to be able to leave this kind of a legacy that my grandchildren can look at and be inspired by them. You know, let me tell you, the one thing I do is I had an extraordinary good collection of books, architectural books.
Well, Nick Gianopulos, thank you. We wish you all the best with the book and with your family. Thank you for speaking with us today.
Thank you. I was highly complimented to be so considered. And I hope I haven't disappointed you.